Hello friends, so today we will be seeing and we will be learning about plants. We see various types of plants around us. Some are trees, some are herbs, shrubs, climbers and creepers. So if we see around us, we will find all these five categories. First coming to herbs, oregano, coriander, mint, thyme, rosemary, you will find all these herbs. You would have heard all the names of these herbs. If we go ahead to see how does the herbs look like, they are very small plants like grass, rice with very tender stem and small roots. You would have very soon seen a coriander plant. You would have got this coriander dhania at your house. You will see how short are the roots and how are the leaves. They do not have branches. Now coming to the shrubs. Shrubs, they have hard branches, okay, they have hard branches and they will start branching out right from the base. You will start having many branches. They form a bushy nature. They just form like a bush. So these are the shrubs. Okay, next coming to the trees. Trees have got thick woody stem and then the branches are at the above of the stem. Next, we have climbers. You would have seen a money plant at your home. So the money plant, you will find they will grow attaching itself to the walls. So when the climbers, their stems are very, very thin, they cannot stand erect. So they will take the support and climb. Next, we have creepers. Creepers also, the stems are very weak. So, these plants will creep through the ground and start growing like watermelon, like a pumpkin. So, these are called as creepers. Their nature is similar with the difference on how it grows. Creepers grows on land where climbers take the support of any object. Next, coming to the parts of the plants. What are the different parts of the plants? Roots, stem, branches, leaf, flower and fruits. First, coming to the stem. Stem is one of the structural part of the vascular plant. So, those which have vessels. Okay, xylem, phloem and all those. So, you will find towards the outer part of the branch, this is one of the stem. So, the phloem is there and in the center you have the xylem. To test the presence of xylem, you dip the plant in a colored solution and after some time if you see, you will see outside you will have these droplets. These droplets shows that the water is being transported. So, which vessel transports water from the roots to the leaf? It is the xylem. So, this shows this droplets, wherever the colored portion you have, that is the xylem. Next, to test where the phloem lies. So, you take the stem and you just cut the outer part of one and for the other you cut the center part. Both you can dip it in water. So, you have the leaves, the water is being carried, okay. And if the leaves are turgid, they are okay, then that you have the xylem, which is going to carry the water from the stem to the leaves. Whereas the other, you will see the xylem is cut out. So, water is very necessary for the growth of the plant. So, that is why the leaves would have dried off or leaves wilt would have occurred. Okay. So, now you understand that xylem is towards the interior part and whereas phloem is in the surrounding part of a stem. Next, coming to whatever is the function of a stem. Stem is required to support the leaves and the branches and flowers. It also holds up in the sunlight. So, that is what is giving the plant the mechanical strength rather. And they also transfer substances from roots to leaves. Xylem will carry water and minerals from the root to the leaves. And phloem will carry the food from the leaves to the other parts of the plants. if we see here, we will see within the nodes, wherever the leaves are growing, these are the nodes, and the middle part is known as internode, and where the leaves are going. So, you see, from the nodes, the leaves have started coming out. So, now, from the node, when the leaves comes out, there is a petiole, and then the leaf starts. Okay. So, to see the structure of the leaf, we have a petiole, and the big green part is the lamina. In the middle, there is a vein, there is a margin of the leaf, and the end of the leaf is known as the tip, and the middle venation, that is known as the midrib. So, this is the structure of a leaf. Now, what is venation? We will come to it. So, now, the venations are nothing, the veins are nothing but which will carry the food. So now coming on to the venation of the leaves. How are the veins of the leaf distributed inside the leaf? So you will have seen a number of types of leaves that are there, which might have different venations, some reticulate and other parallel venation. When the venation is in the form of a network, they are a mesh-like structure, we say that as reticulate venation. And here, when the venations are parallel to each other, we say it as a parallel venation. Now, to differentiate between parallel and reticulate venation, veins which run parallel to one another from the base to the tip of the leaf is parallel venation, whereas veins are arranged in a net-like pattern on both sides of the midrib, that is reticulate venation. Parallel venation, it is the main characteristics of monocot, whereas reticulate venation is seen in dicot. Examples for parallel is banana, bamboo, reticulate is hibiscus, mango. Now, what are the various functions of leaves? Leaves basically are the kitchen of the plant. They are the food makers. They make the food through photosynthesis. Then leaves also, there is an exchange of gases, or there is a respiration that takes place through the stomata. Then they also protect vegetative and floral buds. Water transport, transpiration is also, it is their function, and it also helps in the germination, which is, it, for example, bryophyllum. So, these are the basic functions of a leaf. Manufacture of food, exchange of gases, protect vegetative and floral buds, water transport, that is transpiration, and then store food during germination. So, that is also a part of the function of the leaves. Okay. Now, coming to transpiration, if you cover a plant with a plastic cover, you will see some droplet water. The excess water, the removal of excess water from the plant, this is known as transpiration. So, water is absorbed by the roots, which moves to the leaves, and then the water from the leaves, it gets evaporated. So, that is transpiration. Now, what is photosynthesis? When carbon dioxide will combine with the water, it will form oxygen and glucose in presence of sunlight and chlorophyll. Sunlight is in the nature, whereas chlorophyll is a green pigment which is there in the plant. And whenever it produces glucose, we can confirm it by the test for starch, which is iodine test. If you can put the leaf in a boiling water, then boil it in ethanol and test with iodine. If the leaf is having starch, it will give a blue-black color, whereas if it doesn't have a starch, it will be in a brown color. It will not have a blue-black color. Now, to test if sunlight is required for photosynthesis, we have an experiment. You can cover a leaf in the plant with a black strip on either side and pin it up and keep it for 2 hours. And then after that, we can test for iodine test. Okay. So, we will pluck out this particular leaf from the plant, take off the black strips. Then we will do the iodine test, like we will destarch the leaf putting in the boiling water and again putting it in ethanol, boiling it in ethanol. And then after that, go ahead with iodine test. We will find wherever there was a black strip, it tested negative for iodine test. So it gave brown color. The areas were blue-black in color. So that is why we can say that sunlight is necessary for photosynthesis. Next, you would have seen these kinds of plants, which is partially white and partially green in nature. So it has chlorophyll in the green part, whereas the other parts it is white, where it has no chlorophyll. Now to test whether chlorophyll is necessary, we will again take this particular leaf, sketch that part out. This is a variated leaf, and then we will again go ahead with the iodine test. We will find, we can see that wherever there was the green part, whichever was green in color, had tested positive for iodine test, whereas the portion which was not green in color tested negative or had a brown color. Next, we will come to flowers. There are various parts of flowers. Okay, we have the stem, we have the receptacle or thalamus, and this is where all the flowers are being attached. So that is the receptacle or thalamus. Then we have the sepals, which is the green leafy part of the flower. Then we have the colorful part, which is the petal or the corolla. Then we have the male part, which is the stamen, and then the female part, which is the pistil. The pistil has stigma, style, pollen tube, ovary, and within that we have the ovules, whereas the stamen has anther and filament. Also, the stem, it is also being shown here, where I was talking earlier about the xylem in the interior part, phloem in the exterior part, and the cortex area, which is the cambium. Okay, now coming the flower, if we see, it has got four with the circles. There are four circles. If you see here, you will see it clearly. The innermost part is the carpel or the sepal. Next is the stamen. Then we have the petal and then the sepal. Now, in the sepal, you would have seen it is very much seen when the flower is a bud. So, this blooms, this protects the flower when it is a bud. The sepals are located beneath the petal. They are often mistaken as petals. The sepals act as a protective layer around an unopened flower. Next is the petal. Petals are very, very colorful, the colored part. So they are very, very important during the pollination. Okay. So the petals act as a colorful display to attract potential pollinators to the flower, which will take the pollens from one flower to another. The next is the stamen. So there is a filament, and then you will find the stamen, and over here the filament is there. So you will have the powdery matters. The stamen consists of the anther and the filament. The anther produces the pollen and the filament provides support to the anther. So you will have the anther, which is there, and inside that there are the pollen grains and the filament, green color filament you can see. So if you break out the anther, you will find number of pollen grains. So here the yellow color area is the pollen grains, and here the red colors ones are the stigma. Oh, now the pistil part, where you have stigma, style and ovary, the female reproductive structure is called the pistil. The pistil consists of stigma, style, ovary. The stigma is the location of pollination. The style supports the stigma and transports the pollen to the ovary. So this is the function of stigma, style and ovary. Now if you see, there is a stigma which is very sticky, then the style is there, and then inside it you have the ovary. Now if you see both the stamen and the carpel side by side, you will see the ovary part. If we cut open the ovary part, inside we have the ovary walls, and inside that we have small ovules, which are very, very important for reproductions. So here you have the ovary. It's the location of the fertilization. This is where pollen travels to reach the ovule. The embryo will develop here. It is a matured seed, whereas the pedicle is located at the base of the flower. It supports the flower and connects the flower to the stem when present. Pedicle is nothing but the lower area, okay, the stalk of the flower. Next we come to seed. Seed is required for germination. It has a seed coat, it has a food store and the embryo from where it germinates. So here if you see the seed coat, the where it stores the food is known as cotyledon, and the embryonic part is there where the plant grows. So that's it. Thank you.